fog is rolling in. We were told there's no fog on this side. You liars. Liars, you Shetland liars, you.
I thought we were due for yet another day reading our mind-improving books when suddenly, and rather miraculously, halfway through a bacon sandwich, the mist rolled away again in the space of just a few minutes. This is an amazing climate. For us sailors of the modern era, if I may be so bold as to describe myself at 60 as a modern sailor, the sound of departure is a noisy affair as we shout over the roar of the Volvo. For thousands of years, though, departures were quiet affairs with just the sound of wind, the flap of sail and the distant curlews. I've been a sailor for half a century, and the miracle of that tiny, barely perceptible breeze shifting a 4-ton ship box still knocks me sideways and fills me with wonder. When she starts to move and the rudder starts to bite, you get that frisson of pleasure coming through the tiller, up through your arm and into your soul. A truly glorious experience.
Wind is quite strong from the south today, so it will be a bit rough when we get out, but meantime, sailing quietly up this Vo. It's a sort of fetch. My lovely red sail is doing its job. Ha ha!
The mussel farms are as thick as thieves in these Vos, a sentence I'd never expected to utter, but such is this journey. The mussels cling to ropes, hanging beneath the baby bath-sized boys, sucking silently on salt water, hoping to extract the tiniest bits of crud to eat. It takes over a year to grow from a pea-sized baby to an adult, big enough to be harvested, and then without mercy or compassion, plunged alive in their beautiful home-built shells into boiling water. In nature, they cluster together in colonies, so hopefully they will not succumb to too many diseases in this intensive form of agriculture. There's no need to feed them, but their filtering habits mean that they're brilliant at accumulating toxins, one of the reasons I never eat the blighters. As a cameraman, I rather relish the repeating shapes they make. As a sailor, I'd rather they weren't there. Clutter up the place. But for the locals, it's jobs. So it seems as benign a way as you can imagine to exploit this lovely space for profit. Apart from oil and sheep farming, the seafood business is all that's available by way of gainful employment on these islands. That glorious morning, we sailed sedately up the 6-mile stretch of Rhonus Vo and out towards the open Atlantic. The geology continued to be astonishing. These are among the oldest rocks on the surface of the planet. They were formed around 3 billion years ago, deep down below the Earth's crust, where it's all hot and mushy, where they formed into rough layers like a pile of wet lasagna 100 miles deep. They were then forced to the surface by a bubble of molten hot stuff from below, being folded and twisted madly as they came up, so the fault lines between layers are every which way. At one time, these rocks were mighty mountains bigger than the Alps. Shetland is but the stump of a hard place, stuck out in the North Atlantic, where it's under the relentless assault of the ocean rollers driven here by the prevailing westerlies. Then Shetland bobbed up and down a bit with a million years of ice ages, creating the dramatically cliffed deep water vows that are the distinctive feature of this place and which prompted the Vikings to decide that this looked and felt like home. Damn, this is so different from the gentle, muddy salt marshes of my native East Anglia. But what a place for a sea kayaker. Up here in Shetland, with its crenellated cliffs, you can see why they do it. I too feel the desire to get in close. I envy the kayakers their youth. But here I am, an old bloke in a well-found small boat in a brilliant place on a lovely day, having a sail that will remain with me for the rest of my life. As my old dad used to say, count your blessings and forget your woes. As we headed on south, the breeze started to freshen, and she started to get into the groove.
This is the Centaur bungee steering. It's doing pretty well, actually. It's quite rough.
As the old Centaur clacked and bobbed while self-steering her way past these ancient headlands, she went from regions of old to new. Some, the 3 billion year old Methuselahs, others, 500 million year old Johnny-come-latelys, laid down when Shetland was a tropical paradise the other side of the equator. Listen to the names mankind has given to these billion year old formations. To read them out sounds like poetry coming down to us from our forefathers. Feather, Ochran, Head, Rayness, Villains of Hanovo, Head of Stanchy, the Bruddens, Ishaness, the Runk, the Drongs, Dorhelm, Nibon, Nebinsay, Hamar, Vementry, Braganess, Papa Little, Tubrek, Catfell. Bloody marvellous, aren't they? Of course, the rocks don't care what we call them. Our existence as humans is but a blip in time to them. It had been a lovely sail, not a drop of rain, plenty of sun. Feckin' cold, but that was all right. It's midsummer, Shetland. What do you expect? A girl in a bikini? We sailed on south with a strong wind shoving us onwards. As we came down through St. Magnus Bay and past Muckle Row, we had to motor a bit, but there's nothing wrong with that because we were back close under those old rocks. Such a lot of wondrous stuff to marvel at and put our brief human existence into perspective. In a place as glorious as this, even motoring is a pleasure. Still not as good as sailing, though. Then, as we turned the corner between Swarback's Min and Bustavo, the waves flattened out and the wind came blasting at us from the east. That glorious miracle of wind in sail and hull on water took over. We were going against a very modest ebb tide, but with the strong wind just ahead of the beam, we rolled out the full Genoa, and with a single reef in the main, the old girl started to pick up some real speed. 5.5 knots is a braw rate in a crap boat. The tiller started to gently vibrate under Jill's hand, as the boat really started to go at it. She was just flying along at 6.5 knots against a quarter of a knot of ebb tide. I have never before, nor ever since, experienced such a thing. The powerful wind, the flat water, the gentle heel meant that those slightly canted towed-in keels were sucking out all the leeway. The boat was sailing absolutely perfectly. I had no idea a Centaur could do such a thing. I'm just going to let these shots run for a bit. You'll seldom see a Centaur going as well as she is here. Just imagine how a decent boat would be travelling under these conditions.
Against the tide. Absolutely amazing. So it's just a nice run up. We're just reaching across here, across the Min, coal deep. Then we're going to sail up here to Bray. And there are pontoons in electricity. And the boat is going superbly.
And then, just as we were getting ready to drop the sails, they appeared, like dragonflies in the breeze, the most stripped-out basic sailing machines yet designed by man. When on a fast-moving windsurfer, you are part of the physics of the machine. You feel the wind through the straining muscles of your upper body and the waves through your legs and feet. As a former windsurfer, I miss the physical perfection of the thing. I have never felt so in touch with speed as when I was windsurfing. It beats bikes, horses and dinghies into a cocked hat. Clearly, Jill and I weren't the only ones out here relishing this perfect day for fast sailing. But suddenly our 6.6 knots didn't seem that much at all. Still, it was one of the top five sails experienced by this ancient mariner.
Go in front of this other yacht, Jill. Fender on the right.
Bray, Bray, such a dull place, can barely fill but half a day. Super safe, brand new council pontoons, showers, supermarket and a pub. The boats here are different from our previous Shetland harbours. Recreational vessels outnumber the working boats by 3-1. There's oil money here, you see, comes from the nearby Sullom Voe. Loads of dinghies and windsurfers and almost every vessel held down by concrete blocks. Even the big ones. This must be a very windy place, which I guess is why it's home to the Shetland Windsurfing Club. The village has absolutely nothing to commend it apart from the overall neatness. I could never live in Bray, and I don't say that very often about a place so close to the sea. That night we dined in the award-winning chip shop. It was bloody good. It bills itself as the most northerly chip shop in Britain, and therefore, I presume, the world. Jill ate the local mussels. She declared them absolutely delicious and seems to have escaped unharmed. I'm a pie man myself. I like my meat cooked to buggery. I got up early the next morning. This far in the north, it's light by 2, so while Jill buried herself in the forepeak under a pile of sleeping bags, trying to pretend that she had a less hyper husband, I fired up the engine and chug-fuggered out into Buster Voe. Look at that vista opening up. What a treat. It's not really Essex, is it? Amazingly, the muscle men were up harvesting already. It looks like bloody hard work to me. Then the wind arrived.
Flat water, which is great. Deep reef main, again, as per usual. There are three things that you can go up. You can go up to Vaux, you can go up to Ape. But first of all, I'm going into this little labyrinth of channels behind an island called Vemetry. Strange name. This fantastic labyrinth, look. So we come from here, it was a beat out of here against the tide, round the back of Muckle Row, in front of Papa Little, and then we're coming in across here and into this little place here, which is called Uyea Sound. Uyea Sound. No idea how to pronounce that.
I thought it would be rather fun to circumnavigate Vemetry, shaped like a piece from a jigsaw puzzle, with a seriously narrow gap between it and mainland Shetland. In the Second World War, the island was transformed into a massive gun emplacement to keep the pesky Jerrys at bay. The attraction for me was the gap, just a few yards wide and only slightly deeper than the keels on the Centaur.
This is a sea kayaker's paradise. Around here. And pretty good for sailors too, 19 metres.
I always like to think that the only thing between me and the rocks is the occasional sea kayaker, and there he was. My heart was pounding as we came up to it. Take a look at the charts of the route. Jolly good fun. All done without a chart plotter.
That was very fun.
Stupid. Came down to about 5 feet. We're tacking, coming to about 10 yards from each shore, and it's still 15 metres. But every now and again, there's this sort of thing, which is a bit of a frightening thing to see. Just going to see if it's on the chart. Count counterintuitively, the chart shows the channel running along here. And there's this island called Green, and it is an island, and it appears to have two sheep on it. So we've got 37 metres underneath us, surprisingly. Jill did just spot a rock that I didn't know was there. So we are going very carefully. And then after this island, Green and Linger, we then head pretty close to a little pair of islands and then to Swarbrick's Head. Sheep, did you swim there? And then after this island, Green and Linger, we then head pretty close to a little pair of islands and then to Swarbrick's Head. So, we came down here, round here, round Papa Little, into Uyea Sound, through this tiny gap here, round here, Mr. Rock there, just around these two islands, and up back to Swarbrick's Head, and then we'll come into Swarbrick's Min, whatever Swarbrick's Min means.
Can tell us Swarbrick's Head because it's got three gun emplacements on it.
Nothing unique in that, but this one still has the gun.
I guess removing it was a bit hard. Two of them have still got guns.
No!
32 metres. Thank you.
This is the racing fleet from Aith. They're doing a round Papa, apparently, today.
It was the annual regatta. Three yachts and a mobo. In Shetland, they race with dodgers and spray hood deployed. And why not?
Up towards Aith now. The saw the racing fleet coming down here and they're going around Papa Little. I don't know whether we'll see them again. Maybe as they come back down this side. So we're going to beat up to Aith, just take some pictures and then... Sheds here, I wonder what these were. Kids' playground. What about that house then?
Yes, I like
that one. That one? Okay. Let's have that one.
So I quite like that going on there.
You like the green one?
The new one.
Okay, let's have that one.
How you persuade the people who thought they were building it for themselves that they're building it for us.
Oh, you just go building man and say, I want one like that. Names are growing on me. We've got down at Aith, we've got East Boroughforth, we've got Sound of Hoobensetter, Coalness, Grobsness, Point of Muller, Ness of Noonsborough, Songerness, Vaux of Clooster, Dister. Muckle, you see the word muckle a lot.
We then went up through the gap between Papa Little and the mainland where the semi-redundant plant from the partially resting fish farm was all over the place. Some bits afloat and some scattered across the pastures. Bloody mess. Then a quick whip around Linger and back towards the Atlantic. As we came around Muckle Row and into the Min, Shetland did one of those amazing weather changes. The moggy mist suddenly rolled away and the sun came out. Woohoo! And the wind died. We motored then and followed the coast for a few hours with the engine, our two-cylinder diesel-sipping Sven the Volvo, chugging away beneath us. Thank you. There was only one bit of difficult navigation when we came inside Papa Stour. We had to do some back bearings on one of the rocks to avoid another lot. Yet again, I wished I had a chart plotter.
Tips of the island with the mainland. 230 degrees and then 265 in a certain direction, and then back, taking a back bearing on the island and then out on 60 degrees. Generally, I'm not in favour of dodgers because they slow down the boat and they get in the view. But here in Shetland, the weather has not been perfect. So we have had the dodgers on a fair bit. But that means that when you're, you know, it's windy and you're sitting down and you're hiding behind the dodgers, you can't really see. So my wife has come up with the solution of just taking one down. Because you're going along the coast, you always want to be looking at the coast. You know, the sea is pretty much the sea. So the land for the last few days has been on our left-hand side. And so we've got one dodger up.
So we get shelter so that we can see and we get the view.
Good, eh?
Then towards evening, the weather went a little bit awry and it started raining. The spray hood went up, the camera was put away, Jill went below to cook and I stood out in the rain watching the scenery drift by. Our planned journey to Scalloway was put on hold and we headed for the nearest council pontoons at Skelder. It was too wet for the good camera, but I shot this on the little waterproof one.
We dropped the hook in the Firth, and then about 3 o'clock the wind started howling and it started raining, so we thought it's going to be a good place to spend the night. And about 2 hours away is Skelder, which is a new marina which was built a couple of years ago. It's got showers, it's got washing machines, it's got electricity, and since I'm now soaking, then electricity is a good thing because it gives me a chance to dry stuff out. So we're going to go and hide here for the night and see what the next morning brings. Quite a lot of rocks to avoid on the way, and visibility was declining fast. And as you can see, it is raining a bit. Oh, a magnificent collection of lobster pots here. Look at all those. Exciting, isn't it?
Five yachts.
Yeah. Mm. Oh, goodness gracious me, look at the size of that monster. Let's go right on the end there, look. So we'll put it on the right hand side.
Furthest pontoon.
Yeah. That is a big yacht. Major yacht.
I'm sorry about the wet end to this film, but this is real sailing. We were there for 3 nights and 2 days. I saw, walked and observed every square inch of the place. Bugger all internet too.
decide this. The other thing I'm curious about is to why mobos think that they need so many aerials. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 aerials. 11 aerials. Shetlanders do occasionally do weird things, and there are these things just on this road bridge. And then there's this. You know, I've no idea what that is. Here is a Disney character, a wooden cow, maybe. It's had its head knocked off, and there is a flashing dwarf. With the little bits of art and insanity, I just think that the people who live in low population areas, they feel a need to put their mark on the landscape. I've noticed it in America. You see giant cabbages, or one man had a flock of turkeys made out of old plough parts, or they bury cars up to their nose. It's just something to say, this is me. They're validating themselves in some way. One other weird tradition up here is they put furniture in the bus stops. There's one with a sofa, there's another one with a computer that doesn't work, it's just there for effect. Standard lamp. And for a while there was a dummy being moved around from bus stop to bus stop all over the islands.